Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Madness of Mercury by Connie DeMarco, narrated by Hana Lass. There are those among us who pray, who hunt under the guise of trust. They kill not just the physical body, but the psyche, the dream of the soul. They are the clever ones, the dexterous and silver-tongued. They sway the weak, the old, the gullible, and the infirm. They are the tricksters of the universe and work through enchantment. They are ruled by Mercury, a god of great cunning, a thief and a prowler. With no place of his own, the ancients ascribed to him rulership over borders, secret passageways, and crossroads where suicides are buried. He alone escorted souls to the underworld because only he could move freely in the world above and the world below. In our time, he leads unwary travelers astray to meet their own twisted shadow in the dark night. It was a new client whose predicament recalled this mythology to me. My name is Julia Bonatti, Julia Elizabeth Bonatti, and I'm an astrologer. For too long, I had worked with practical daylight interpretations of the natal chart. For too long, I had happily delineated charts concerned with mundane issues. What's the best time to plan our trip? When should I invest? I've thought of returning to school. Can I afford it? It was Evandra Gamble and her family and the events surrounding them that indelibly marked me, that caused me to know the dark side of the god. 1. Long fingers gripped my wrist with a surprising strength. She's trying to kill me. A network of veins on Evandra's hand bulged like blue worms burrowing under the dry parchment of her flesh. Evandra Gamble was the elderly aunt of my longtime client, Dorothy Sanger, the very she to whom Evandra referred. I straightened in my chair. You can't mean that. Ha, Evandra replied. You think you know her, my charming niece? Believe me, you don't. Her face shifted. Her watery blue eyes held my gaze. I'm afraid, Julia. Her voice quavered. Please help me. That's why I needed you to come here today for my reading. Her grip on my wrist tightened. I sighed inwardly. I'd formed a few rules over the course of my practice. Number one is that my clients come to me for readings. For professional reasons, it's important that I work on my own turf. If a client is new or not referred by someone I know well, I might arrange for a private room at the Mystic Eye, an occult shop in North Beach owned by my friend Gail. Today, I was breaking that rule. Evandra was on the verge of turning 90 and had suffered a fractured hip. She was on the mend, but mobility was still difficult. Dorothy had asked me to visit the rambling house on Telegraph Hill for her aunt's sake. I complied, imagining my new client's questions would fall in the category of health or decisions over her final wishes. I certainly never expected Evandra to accuse her own flesh and blood of murder. Dorothy's devoted to you. She's taken a leave from nursing to stay here with you. Why do you say that? I replied with disbelief. Evandra's eyes shifted and grew wary. Her expression closed. She sniffed. I hoped that you of all people would listen and believe me. She released my hand. Her arm was frail, as if muscle had separated from bone. Her thin shoulders and collarbone looked as light and hollow as a bird's. She slumped back against the flowered cushions on the large armchair and closed her eyes. Evandra's natal sun and Mercury were under the sway of a Neptune transit. I knew she'd be physically depleted, her normal energy sapped. For an elderly woman recovering from a fracture, I was concerned. Neptune's effect on her Mercury, the planet related to mental acuity, could cause confusion, perhaps even delusions. Was the Neptune transit signaling the start of some form of elder senility? I just wasn't certain. Please believe me, Evandra. Your thinking is affected during this time.
You mean you think I'm losing it, don't you?
She glanced at me sharply. No, I don't think that. But anyone at any age would be affected. Please, please reserve judgment, especially of Dorothy, until this time period is over. I watched her carefully, not sure how to put my fears into words. There is another thing I should mention. Illnesses can be extremely difficult to diagnose under this planet's transit. I didn't want to frighten her, but I had to be as honest as possible. One worry is that you could have an adverse reaction to medication. She pursed her lips and continued to stare at me, an expression I was sure was designed to engender guilt. My answer hadn't satisfied her. I mentally reviewed my work on her chart. Had I missed anything? Was it my own insecurity? Or was I just being guilted? I'll tell you what. I'll have a further look and check your lunar returns for the next couple of months. The lunar return chart describes the current month based on the moon's return to its natal position, and I'll see if there's a period of time during this transit that's more threatening.
My niece is your client. You have her chart, don't you?
Yes, of course.
Have a look at that too. Please, before it's too late.
I couldn't respond. The thought that Dorothy would ever harm her aunt was outrageous and unthinkable. The woman I knew was a highly regarded and experienced nurse. She had devoted her life to taking care of people, and now she had put her work on hold to care for her aunts, Evandra and her younger sister, Eunice. Evandra sat forward in her seat.
I need Luis. Can you fetch him, dear? Just pull that tassel over there.
She pointed to a length of cord near the canopy bed that undoubtedly connected to a series of bells below. I rose and passed by the window. Luis was below in the garden, trimming a hedge. He was the sister's valet, gardener, chauffeur, and all-around gopher. A short man, thickly built, with graying hair, he maintained a gentle and long-suffering demeanor, as he was called upon often for any number of odd jobs.
Damn and blast this hip, Evandra fidgeted in her chair. I hate being so helpless.
I pushed open the casement window and waved to Luis. He nodded and wiped his brow with a red bandana, holding up a calloused finger to indicate he'd be upstairs in a moment.
Old age is not for sissies, Julia.
She grimaced in pain.
Why, when I was young, I could party, as they say, with the best of them.
Luis arrived a few moments later and knocked. I hurried to the door and opened it.
There you are, Luis.
Evandra raised her arms.
Help me to the bed.
He lifted Evandra's slender form with ease and deposited her gently on the large bed, then covered her with a crocheted quilt. Her complexion had grown pale.
I'll be working on the back lawn, miss, but you pull the cord if you need help. Miss Dorothy can call me.
Thank you, Luis. Please tell that niece of mine to stop baking and do something useful around here. For all we know, she's slipping arsenic in those blasted cookies she's always making.
I will tell her, miss.
Luis smiled and winked at me as he shut the door behind him. Evandra leaned her head back and pulled the quilt up to cover her arms.
I have to rest now, dear. Will you come see me again?
I'll stop by again if you like. Perhaps tomorrow.
Thank you.
She sighed heavily and closed her eyes. I had been dismissed. I gathered up my notes and charts and stepped softly across the heavily draped bedroom and pulled the solid oak door shut behind me. The second floor hallway was dim, lined with dark wood wainscoting and lit only by a few wall sconces leading to the top of a curving staircase. A stained glass window filtered outside light onto the landing. It was only mid-afternoon, but the sky had grown dark, muting the brilliant reds and blues of the window. Heavy Pacific storms were closing in from the north, and San Francisco would be buffeted by wind and rain through the holidays. At the foot of the stairs, I called to Dorothy. She didn't answer, but a sweet and toasty aroma filled the foyer. I followed the short hallway toward the rear of the house and pushed through the swinging door to the kitchen. At the other end of the room, a wall of windows overlooked the back garden, and beyond that, a view of the city and the bay to the north. Black clouds, roiling and heavy with rain, were visible beyond the Golden Gate and the Marin Headlands. The storm would hit within a few hours. Dorothy worked at the center island, kneading dough, a full-length white apron tied over her loose slacks and long-sleeved red sweater. She looked up and smiled.
How did it go with the Dowager Queen?
I laughed. Fine, I guess. Dorothy saw the expression on my face.
What's wrong?
I pulled a stool up to the island, watching Dorothy knead and slap her dough. That's when I broke rule number two, never talk about a client's reading.
I have to ask you something.
Dorothy stopped her work, wiping flour-coated hands on a dish towel. Has there been any hint of senility or psychosis? Medically, I mean. Dorothy looked puzzled for a moment.
I've worked a lot with elderly patients. It certainly happens. They can be perfectly normal their whole life, but with age, do the strangest things.
Such as?
Oh, Dorothy trailed off. Imagining that someone's stealing their money or draining their bank accounts. One man I cared for filled his living room with stacks of newspapers, floor to ceiling. Don't ask me what that's about, but it does happen.
Why? What did she say to you?
I didn't have the heart to repeat Evandra's fears. I'd known Dorothy for a couple of years, had nursed her through marital problems and a current separation from her husband, and had come to like and respect her. I looked at her open face and the concerned look in her eyes and decided for once to keep my mouth shut, or at least practice the tact that Sagittarians are not famous for. She seems to have a great level of fear and believes that she's in danger.
I can't imagine why.
Dorothy brushed a strand of hair from her forehead with the back of her hand.
She couldn't be safer. She'll probably potter along for several more years. When she's able to get around, I can go back to work. She has Eunice, her baby sister, living here. We have our housekeeper, Alba. The poor woman has her hands full taking care of this mausoleum. And Gudrun, their companion, also lives in. And I plan to have a nurse stop by every day for a while. Maybe a long while. We'll see.
Tough on you.
Oh, I'm used to it. It's just harder when it's your own family. If Richard and I were still together.
Dorothy trailed off. I waited, careful to gauge her emotional state. Personally, I was glad Dorothy had separated from her controlling husband. I couldn't exactly say that to her, but I was relieved she was getting back on her feet. She took a deep breath.
But we're not.
She smiled ruefully.
You're young, Julia, It's hard for you to understand.
I understood all right. Death had taken away my options, but this wasn't the time to remind her. Not that young. Dorothy looked at me.
You know, all the time I've known you, I've never asked how old you are.
36.
See, that's young, she smiled. I was going to say, if we were still together, I suppose I wouldn't feel as free to be staying up here, keeping an eye on everything. And I'm only here till Evandra's up and about. So, everything works out for the best, I suppose.
Dorothy sprinkled some flour from a small glass bowl over the wooden cutting board and returned to kneading the dough.
She's definitely stronger every day, but she can't be on her own. You haven't met Eunice yet, have you? The baby of the family. She's only 87.
Dorothy chuckled.
Gudrun keeps an eye on her, too. And then the renovations.
I noticed. What's that about?
It's the conservatory. Evandra finally agreed to do something about it. There's dry rot around the window frames. Most of them need replacing. This is such an old house, and I've been worried. My aunts really haven't been up to keeping on top of maintenance and repairs, so I figured this was the best time to have it done. I just hope it'll be finished by the time I'm ready to get back to my own life.
As if in response to Dorothy's explanation, I heard a power saw rev up from a distance at the far end of the house.
That's them now. We hired an architect to oversee the contractors. Some of the plumbing in the conservatory needs to be replaced, too. But the architect's great with these old houses, and his crew can pretty much come and go through the formal garden on the side of the house without disturbing us very much.
Dorothy spread her dough carefully over the board. An apple and cinnamon mixture was warming on the stovetop, and my stomach was reminding me I hadn't eaten since breakfast.
What are you making?
Apple pastries, little turnovers. I make them every Christmas. My aunts love them. I thought it might cheer Evandra up, especially.
The sound of a gasoline-powered mower drowned out the rest of Dorothy's response. Dorothy glanced toward the windows.
Damn, what's he doing?
The carpenter?
No, Louise.
Dorothy walked to the windows and peered out into the garden.
He probably wants to finish the lawn before the rain starts.
A low stone wall formed the perimeter of the back garden, delineating an edge where the ground dropped off to a steep cliff marked with rocky outcroppings. I joined Dorothy at the window and followed her line of sight. The power mower was running, unattended, butting against the stone wall. A red bandana hung from the vibrating handlebar of the machine. Dorothy looked puzzled.
He shouldn't leave that thing like that.
Where did he get off to?
She tossed her dish towel on the table, heaved a sigh, and opened the back door to the garden.
Louise? Louise, she called.
I followed her out the door and joined her on the lawn. The wind was whipping fiercely across the hillside, and the sky had grown even darker. In the distance, the sea churned black in the bay. Dorothy's apron billowed like a sail in the wind. She strode purposefully across the grass to the mower and hit the control, silencing the monster. She turned her head to speak to me and hesitated, then turned back and peered over the low wall. Something had caught her eye. She was still for a moment and then took two steps backward.
What is it, Dorothy?
Her face had drained of color.
It's Louise. He's down there.
Her voice quivered.
I think he's dead.
2. The rough stones of the perimeter wall stood only knee high. I leaned over carefully, fighting vertigo, and looked down. Louise's body lay on an outcropping of rock perhaps 20 feet below. His sightless eyes stared up at the darkening sky. His leg was bent at an extreme angle, and a small pool of blood surrounded his head. Dorothy was frozen in place, staring at his body. I pulled her back from the edge, resisting the feeling that the ground might collapse under us and send us both careening down the hillside. I grasped her shoulders and led her into the kitchen. She sat heavily on the stool I had just vacated. She had seen plenty of death in her working life, but none so close to home.
What the hell happened, Julia?
Dorothy looked more confused than horrified. I'll call 911. You stay right here. Several hours later, the paramedics, fire trucks, and police drove back down the hill toward North Beach. Fortunately, Gudrun, the sister's companion, had kept Eunice in her quarters. Evandra, sedated with a pill for pain, slept through the chaos, blissfully unaware of Luis' death. The coroner was noncommittal, except to say that the fall most probably killed the gardener, but it wouldn't be ruled accidental until the autopsy was complete. The real question was, how did a man who was familiar with the terrain tumble over a low wall?
I've told them time and time again to do something about that wall. It's just too low, and especially now that the rains have washed away some of the hillside and vegetation.
Telegraph Hill had been compromised since the mid-1800s, when sailing ships quarried rock from the bayside of the hill to use as ballast. Several years before, heavy rains had caused a mudslide, destroying and burying buildings below. The Gamble House was built on solid bedrock, a very desirable thing in earthquake territory, but I had to agree with Dorothy about the low wall.
They need to build that up or replace it with a tall wrought iron fence. They're elderly ladies. Either one of them could have toppled over. My God,
Dorothy cried. The apple mixture on the stove had hardened to a dry mass. The turnovers were forgotten. I was nibbling on a piece of toast and sipping a cup of strong tea that Dorothy had fixed.
Julia, thanks for staying with me.
I couldn't very well leave you with this.
I'm just heartbroken. We know his family. He's worked for my aunts for more than 20 years.
My heart sank, imagining a family's grief. Sudden, unexpected death. The cruelest blow of all.
I knew he had some heart trouble, but could he have had an attack and lost his balance?
Dorothy ran her fingers through her thick, strawberry blonde hair and slumped into a chair.
I suppose I should put that mower away in the shed before it rains.
Stay here. I'll take care of it. The storm that had seemed so imminent had mercifully held off, making the job of removing Luis's body from the cliffside easier. Paramedics had pushed the mower several feet away from the spot where we had found it. Struggling with the ungainly beast in the soft grass, I managed to turn it around and wheel it to the small room attached to the garage. I lifted and pushed the mower over the doorstep into an empty corner. An overhead light bulb illuminated the space. Various gardening tools were attached to one wall, all cleaned and oiled. A container of screwdrivers and small wrenches sat on a rough wooden workbench. Several photos were pinned to the wall above the bench. A wedding snapshot of a smiling young couple, and school photos of a dark-haired boy and girl. Somewhere in the city right now, Luis's family would be receiving the news of his death. I had visited Dorothy at the house a few times over the last couple of weeks. That's when I had first met Evandra and had seen Luis, always working. Earlier today, he had been trimming the boxwood hedges at the front of the house. I had called out to him while I waited at the front door, and he had responded with a smile and a wave of his hedge clippers. His jacket hung on a hook next to the door above an extra pair of well-used work boots. I didn't see the wide-brimmed hat he always wore when he was working outside. I wondered if it had fallen to the bottom of the cliff. I untied the red bandana from the handle of the mower and hung it next to his jacket. A kitchen mug and a small plate sprinkled with crumbs sat on the workbench. I picked them up and, turning off the light, locked the door behind me. Returning to the kitchen, I dumped the dishes in a tub of hot water in the sink. Dorothy was still seated on the stool, staring into space. I squeezed her hand. "If you'd like, I can stop by tomorrow." She looked up.
"I'd appreciate that, Julia. I've got to tell my aunts, and I want to reach his family somehow this evening, if it's possible. They'll be devastated."
Dorothy quickly wiped her eyes with a corner of her apron.
"I'm devastated."
She pushed herself away from the table and stood. I slipped on my jacket as Dorothy followed me through the swinging door to the front hallway. She opened one side of the massive oak entrance and stood watching as I hurried to my car. The sky had grown completely dark. Storm clouds blotted out any possible view of moon or stars. With luck, I'd get home before the rain hit, and if I were really lucky, I'd beat the worst of rush hour traffic. My apartment is a small flat on the second floor of a duplex out on the avenues, north of Golden Gate Park, in an area known as the Outer Richmond. I rarely see my downstairs neighbors, so I feel as if I have the building to myself most of the time. It's fog central, and I love it. Many days are bright, sunny, and windy, but so close to the Pacific, the fog rolls in every afternoon like clockwork. Temperatures in San Francisco are always cool and vary so little that it's sometimes difficult to tell February from July, except July can be even colder. I was overjoyed to reach home. My haven is small, only 4 rooms, but I have a great rent and a street-level garage to park my car. I'm several blocks from the ocean on one side, and in the other direction, a short walk to the Golden Gate Straits. Originally, this western part of the city was nothing but miles of sand dunes over bedrock with too much fog, the entire area considered undesirable and uninhabitable, ignored, until population explosion forced development. Some San Franciscans turn their collective nose up at this part of town because of the wind and the fog, but I can't imagine living anywhere else. My neighborhood may not be Knob Hill or Pacific Heights, but I have the ocean and the sound of foghorns to lull me to sleep at night. The deluge began just as I pulled up to my building. I hit the garage opener, waited for the door to rise, and drove in. Grabbing my case and purse, I hurried through the door at the back of the garage and climbed the wooden steps to my kitchen. Rummaging for my keys, I managed to get the door unlocked with one hand while holding my case over my head with the other. I flipped on the kitchen light. Wizard, my cat, sat at attention next to his food tray, waiting patiently for my return. "Wiz," I reached down to scratch his ears. "I know, I'm late. It's been a very rough day." Rainwater dripped off my jacket onto his fur. He meowed and backed away from me, circling around my feet to take up another position close to his bowl. A big hint. "Okay, I get the message." Wizard is completely black and weighs close to 20 pounds. He does his best to converse with me and has a large vocabulary of meows, purrs, and quacks to let me know what's on his mind. I shrugged out of my jacket and hung it on a hook in the laundry room, kicked off my shoes, and dropped my case and purse on top of the washer. Wizard rubbed his head forcefully against my leg and quacked several times to chide me for being late for dinner and to thank me for finally coming home. Would he still love me if I couldn't operate the can opener? I plunked a fresh can of Fancy Beast into his bowl. He dove in and ignored me to seriously focus on his dinner. I was famished, and the apartment was freezing. I turned the thermostat up and dug a container of split pea soup out of the refrigerator. I'm not much of a cook. My parents died when I was young, and I was raised by my grandmother, Gloria, who took care of all that. I was always too much on the go to be fussing in the kitchen. Since then, I've managed to figure out how to make soup. My nod to domesticity. Gusts of wind and rain were beating against the windows. I closed the drapes in the living room to block out the storm and lit a few candles on the mantel. I got a fire started, and by the time I devoured my soup, the apartment had warmed. I pulled on a pair of jeans, fuzzy slippers, and a heavy sweater, and settled in by the fire, a notepad and my laptop on the coffee table. I needed to catch up with the work which, under normal circumstances, I would have handled today. I also wanted to keep my promise to Evandra by checking her lunar returns for the next couple of months. Images of Luis lying on the rocks below kept flashing before my eyes. I knew the man only slightly, but I was sure his death would affect the sisters a great deal. My private clientele keeps me fairly busy, but thanks to Don Forrester, my old friend from college days who runs the research department at the Chronicle, I had met Lester Bartley, an editor who convinced me to do a weekly column of astrological advice. The Ask Zodiac feature had become a greater success than anyone had anticipated. Don jump-started the column with fake birth dates and outrageous problems, and now the newspaper was receiving more and more letters and emails every day. Samantha, Les's editorial assistant, routinely screens emails and letters, weeds out the cranks, and then sends the lot to me. For the ones I don't have time to answer, she returns a form response with a list of ethical local astrologers who might welcome more business. I'm thrilled to have the additional income to tide me over slow times, like now, with the holidays approaching. But I was starting to worry. I was afraid I had created a monster that would eat up my time and interfere with my private clients. The odd thing is, I never set out to be an astrologer. I have a master's degree in anthropology from San Francisco State. That's where I met Michael, my fiancé. We had both planned on teaching careers and a life together. Those plans were crushed when Michael was struck down in a hit-and-run accident in front of his apartment building. The driver was never found. That was 2 years ago. Once the slow acceptance of Michael's death hardened in my mind, I slid into a long depression. Exhaustion dogged my steps. Days and weeks passed in which I stared at the ceiling and the walls of my bedroom until the hard surfaces seemed to breathe like a living thing. I couldn't stand the sympathy I saw in everyone's eyes. What little energy I had, I used to convince everyone I was fine. I only wanted to be left alone to mourn the life I had lost. One morning, I woke and realized the pain wasn't gone, but it had lessened. I was a long way from lighthearted, but I was alive and knew I wanted to live. I cleaned out every drawer, closet, and cubbyhole. I packed the remnants of my former life in a large cardboard box and taped it firmly shut. I gave away all that was superfluous. My Sunset District apartment near the university held too many memories. I gave notice to my landlord and found my current digs north of the park near the foghorns. And, for lack of a better idea, I took a job at a law firm downtown just to make ends meet. It was during that time, while browsing through a bookstore, that I came across my first astrology book. Something clicked. I read it avidly. I collected more books and began to study. I gathered data and set up charts. I practiced on friends or anyone who would talk to me. It was the loneliest time of my life, but everything that exists now grew out of that cauldron. Astrology offered a lens through which I hoped to make sense of my own loss. I still study Michael's chart, searching for some sign that might have saved him. I haven't found any answers, but it's never far from my mind. Evandra's chart was on the screen. I clicked the button that would generate a lunar return. The current Neptune transit came into even sharper focus. I didn't like what I was seeing. Perhaps Evandra wasn't suffering from senile dementia at all. Perhaps she truly was in danger, although I found it difficult to believe that Dorothy could be the culprit. I jumped when the phone rang. The display said private caller. Had to be Gail.
Hey.
What are you up to?
Not much. Working on a chart, then I have to get some Zodiac questions done.
Where the hell have you been? You don't call, I don't hear from you. Do I have to email Zodiac to get your attention?
Gail is my closest friend. We met at the Mystic Eye in North Beach. I was browsing for astrology books while she was busy promoting her new business, now the most popular metaphysical shop in the state. She was right. I had been ignoring her messages. Translated, she was really asking if I was depressed. I haven't dated since Michael's death. The holidays were upon us, my grandmother was away on a cruise, and I was truly an orphan this season.
I'm fine, really. Okay, she responded hesitantly. So you can't return a phone call?
I'm sorry. You're right. It's been a weird time. My regular clients always disappear during the holidays, and the Zodiac column's eating up my time. Mercury's retrograde, and it's the last quarter of the moon. I trailed off.
Oh, of course, that explains it, she replied sarcastically. But didn't you say you had a couple of new clients lined up this week?
Today, in fact. But that was fine, but it ended rather badly. I filled Gail in on the events of the afternoon at the Gamble house.
Cripes! Which one is their house?
You know it, I'm sure. It's huge. It's the dark brick one on the left side as you go up toward Coit Tower.
Ah.
Gail was silent for a moment.
What caused the fall?
They're thinking he might have had a heart attack, but no final word as yet. Luis was slightly overweight and supposedly had a mild heart condition. What's odd is he's worked there for years. He was very familiar with the grounds, but the police wouldn't talk to us at all. I sighed. That's all I know.
Julia, why didn't you call me? I was right down the hill at the eye. I could have buzzed up.
I honestly didn't even think of it. I'm really okay, but I feel just awful for Dorothy. Trying to cope with her two aunts and that house and having that happen, and then she's recently separated from her husband.
Listen, you do sound kind of down. The reason I called...
What are you doing for the holidays? Haven't given it a thought. My grandmother's away, and I still haven't done any shopping. Quan invited me to a Buddhist ceremony. I think he wanted to make sure I wasn't alone. Quan Lee is my grandmother's close friend who has lived in the first floor apartment of her house in North Beach for as long as I can remember. He's an herbalist and practices Chinese medicine and acupuncture. He's the closest thing I have to a grandfather, and I love him dearly. Well, it's up to you, but Cheryl wants to cook a big dinner. Cheryl is our other close friend who manages the Mystic Eye. I was thinking we could do it at my place, just the three of us, since we're all orphans this year anyway. That surprised me. Gail usually has a round of posh catered parties to attend over the holidays. Is that what you're up for? Yes, I'm socialed out. I'd love to just be with close friends and not go running all over hell this year. Best invitation I've had. What can I bring? Nothing. Just bring yourself. Cheryl wants to do everything. She's having an attacus domesticus. You and I can get pleasantly buzzed and watch her run around the kitchen. It'll be fun. I laughed. You're on. I'll give you a call later this week. We said goodbye and made girlfriend kissy noises through the phone. Wizard had curled into a fetal position on top of a fuzzy throw close to the fireplace. The wind was buffeting the windows so hard, the rain sounded like gravel being thrown against the glass. The logs were blazing, and I thanked my stars I could snuggle inside tonight with Wizard and work. Samantha had forwarded about 50 emails from the newspaper to my own Ask Zodiac email address. My inbox gets cluttered, and I didn't want Sam's mail to be overlooked. As a weekly column, there was space for only 3 or 4 questions and answers, but now the editor was considering running it as a daily feature. I knew I wouldn't be able to handle that kind of volume, but I was sure other astrologers might be open to filling in and perhaps even taking over if I became too busy. I wanted to choose 8 from this batch, just to make sure I was ahead of my deadlines. To keep the column interesting to as large a group of readers as possible, I like to pick a range of ages and problems. My first pick was a letter from an older man forced into retirement. Dear Zodiac, I've worked as a bookkeeper in the corporate world my entire life. I'm 65 and my company forced me to retire. I'm in decent shape financially. I have a good pension and savings, but I don't know what to do with myself. I've tried to find part-time work, but no luck. I've never felt so lost and useless. Do you see any kind of work on the horizon for me? My birth date is May 4th, 1944, at 10:43 p.m. in Baltimore. Discarded. Poor guy. Worked his whole life and now shoved aside. The man's birth chart showed Venus as the oriental planet, that is, the planet rising first before the sun, a position that can sometimes offer a strong clue to the profession. This man was a natural artist, perhaps a craftsman with his Mars in Virgo. He was someone with artistic yearnings and capable of patient, detailed work. Dear Discarded, your true artistic abilities have never been recognized, much less nourished. A whole new world can open up for you if you would pursue some form of craftsmanship to produce beautiful things. Jewelry design, working in precious metals, is just one possibility that comes to mind. Please take some classes, perhaps at a local university extension, and try your hand. I think you'll be amazed at your abilities and imagination. Believe me, you won't look back. Zodiac. I opened a few more emails and moved a bunch into a folder to consider later. Ones that I felt were not terribly interesting, I set aside to be returned to Sam for her form letter referring the writers to other astrologers. I worked through several more questions and responses, and then saved them all. This was hardly a perfect way to practice astrology, but hopefully, My quick judgments and answers would be spot on and help someone head in the right direction. I clicked back to the inbox and realized 3 more emails had arrived while I had been working. I didn't recognize the various senders. My Ask Zodiac address had been set up only for Samantha, but these new emails weren't from her. My private clients use Julia.Bonatti, and my friends use Julia B. None of them would even know of my Ask Zodiac address. I hesitated. I'm a hopeless non-techie person and rely on my computer for business, so I'm very fearful of viruses. I clicked on the button to open the reading pane and scrolled down. A jolt of fear shot through me. The message read, "Thou shalt not suffer a witch to live." 3. The other 2 emails were along the same biblical lines. "In my name shall they cast out devils," Luke chapter 16, verse 17, and "Neither shall ye use enchantment nor observe times," Leviticus chapter 19, verse 26. A cold knot formed in my stomach. Someone very crazy had figured out my Ask Zodiac address. Someone who wasn't Samantha. I reached for the phone automatically and then realized how late it was. The office had closed hours ago and I didn't have Sam's home number. I'd have to wait till morning. My knowledge of biblical lore is really non-existent. I had no clue about the context of these quotes. However, the message was clear. Someone considered me a witch and thought my work was the work of the devil. I wondered if Sam had received similar missives that she hadn't passed on. Crazy letters along these lines might have come to the newspaper and she hadn't wanted to tell me. I'd ask her tomorrow. She'd probably think I'd be upset, and she'd be right. But this was different. This was my own personal email. Should I delete them? Should I save them in a folder? Block them? Had someone sent me a virus? Something very hateful had invaded my home via computer. I finally decided to delete them from my inbox and trash. I shivered involuntarily. What creeped me out was the fact that they came from different senders. I stared at the blank screen. Maybe I had hit that button too fast. Maybe I should at least have made a note of the sender's addresses. I heaved a sigh and closed my laptop. I put Evandra's notes in her folder and straightened up the living room. The fire had turned to embers, and Wizard was still curled up on the throw. I shed my clothes, slid under the covers, and turned on the electric blanket. The rain still drummed heavily outside. Wizard followed me and climbed onto the bed, curling up in a ball next to me. I picked up my new book on eclipses and managed to read a paragraph before I went unconscious, the lamp still lit. The next morning, I woke, groggy, with a crick in my neck. The events of the day before came flooding back. I tried to push the image of Luis's body being raised from the cliffside out of my head. It wasn't working. Groaning, I climbed out of bed and rummaged in the closet for my leopard print flip-flops and my thrift shop Chinese robe and stumbled out to the kitchen, desperate for coffee. I know. I'm an addict and I really don't care. I put the pot on to boil, thinking I should probably break down and buy one of those coffee makers that can be set up the night before. The problem with that is I'd have to remember to fill it with water and coffee and push the button. A big assumption. Wizard circled my legs and waited patiently while I scooped food into his dish. When the coffee was ready, I filled a mug and added some half and half. I needed caffeine. I had more work to do and a new client coming today. I peeked out the window above the sink. The rain had stopped, but there'd be more. The temperature had dropped radically in the night, and the steam from the boiling kettle had fogged the windows. Wizard climbed onto my lap as soon as I sat down and, stretching his paws, kneaded furiously at my robe as I downed my coffee. The thought of returning to the gamble house depressed me, but I had promised Dorothy and Evandra I'd come back. When the caffeine finally hit, I gently urged Wizard off my lap. I pulled my mop of unruly hair up with an elastic band and jumped in the shower. After I dressed, I straightened up the apartment and shut the damper in the fireplace to keep the heat from escaping. The emails from the night before still preyed on my mind. I checked the clock. It wasn't 9 yet, but Samantha sometimes arrived at the office early. I dialed her number. She answered on the first ring.
Julia, hi, what's up?
Listen, Sam, you didn't give my Ask Zodiac email address to anyone, did you?
No, of course not. No one at all. Why do you ask?
I got a few really strange emails last night.
Strange? What did they say?
I repeated the biblical phrases as best I could.
I didn't write down exactly what they said. I just looked at them with the viewing pane open, and then I deleted them. Creepy, she sighed.
More than one. All three came from different addresses.
Did you give that address to anyone?
No, I only use it for you, for the column.
I don't know what to say. We have your info in the payroll department, your home address and phone, and your Ask Zodiac email, but I don't imagine anyone there would give it out. The emails I send to you all come from the Ask Zodiac address at the Chronicle. The only thing I can think is that someone took the name of the column and just tried different service providers till they hit one that got through.
You screen the letters that come in. Have you seen anything similar before?
No, nothing threatening or strange at all. A lot of them are meandering and don't really have a question. I just send the standard response, you know, we receive many more requests than we can possibly answer, but are happy to refer you to blah, blah, blah.
Well, I just wanted you to know. Hopefully, the only thing they have is that email address.
Maybe you should set up a new one for me.
Good idea. I'll do that. I don't want to use the same one my regular clients have, but do me a favor and don't write it down anywhere, okay?
I promise. What's it going to be?
How about AstroChat? Don't use the word Zodiac anywhere.
I'll remember. So, everything I send you will go to AstroChat from now on.
You can tell Les, but no one else, and I'll delete the Ask Zodiac address.
Maybe you shouldn't delete it, Julia. If it becomes more of a problem, the police can trace it. It takes a while, but I know they can do that. I'm not sure if emails that aren't delivered can be traced if you shut down the address, so maybe it's better to keep it. Just don't read any of that crazy stuff.
Easier said than done, but you're right.
Julia, I'm really sorry. I don't like the idea there could be a leak from our end. Stay in touch, though, and let me know if you get any more.
We hung up, and I placed a call to Don at his office next. It was too early to expect him to be there, but I left a message for him to call me as soon as he arrived. I made another cup of coffee and settled back in to work. There were all kinds of freaks in the world. I couldn't let them get to me. I hoped to squeeze a few more letters in for the column before my client arrived. I skimmed through and finally chose some others that offered a good range of problems. Dear Zodiac, I hope you can help me. I was born at 3:15 a.m. on October 3, 1978. My husband was born March 4, 1976. We were married only last year. Over the last few months, his behavior has changed. In the last few weeks, it's much worse. He's threatened suicide and I'm worried sick. What should I do? Panicked in Petaluma. I groaned. Panicked shouldn't be wasting time writing to Zodiac. She needed to find a shrink in a big hurry. Dear Panicked,
Threats should be taken very seriously. Immediately speak to your doctor or your local hospital about getting help for your husband. Also, talk to anyone at the suicide prevention hotlines who might be able to give you some guidance. This is a time for intervention. His natal chart shows very adverse aspects to his sun sign, indicating a lack of parental support in childhood, possibly even abuse. He is suffering from feelings of worthlessness. He needs immediate help. Following are several names of organizations and 800 numbers where you can get help. Zodiac. I emailed this to Samantha, asking her to reply privately to the sender immediately. This was one I didn't think needed to appear in the column. I was concerned about some of the letters Zodiac was getting. I respond as best I can given the limitations, but I can't help but worry about some of the people who are writing to me. I just hoped that Panicked in Petaluma wouldn't waste a minute. I sighed and opened the next letter. Just as I set up the chart, the doorbell rang. From the top of the stairs, I called down to the front door. It was Dorothy. I hurried down to let her in. She was out of breath.
You don't have a client with you, do you? I'm sorry, Julia. I should have called first.
No, it's fine. I'm working, but I can take a break. How did you manage to get away?
Gudrun's there with my aunt now. I really need to see you.
Sure, come on up. Was this about Louise or something else? I led Dorothy into the office. She sat in my client chair without taking off her coat.
I'm really sorry to barge in like this.
No worries. What's on your mind?
It's Richard, Julia. He wants to get back together,
she blurted out. I nodded noncommittally, but inwardly my brain was short-circuiting.
Can you look at our progressed composite chart again? Maybe things would be different now.
Dorothy's face was flushed. I knew that in her heart of hearts, she had very much wanted her marriage to be a success. After much arguing, stress, and accusations about financial matters, Richard announced he was not happy and moved out. Dorothy was heartbroken. I knew from the charts that Richard was controlling and had a heavy effect on her. She hadn't been on terribly firm ground during all the marital upheaval, but when Richard left, she had fallen apart. Privately, it incensed me that Richard wanted back just when she was getting stronger. My heart was heavy, but there was nothing for it but to pull up the charts and have another look. Okay. I smiled to soften what I knew I would have to say. Here's your progressed chart. And here's Richard's. I turned the computer monitor so she could see the charts. Offering clients a view of the aspects I'm describing often helps them gain a little emotional distance. Progressed charts are based on a theory that the first day of life is indicative of the first year of life. In other words, the 30th year of life is foreshadowed by the 30th day of life. To find out what's currently happening in a relationship, one very good method is to create progressed charts for the two individuals and then set up a composite chart. A composite creates a new chart.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.